the types of bacterial diseases that we'll focus in a little bit more on and the way they're generally classified, although it's not totally logical because there is some overlap, would be the gram-positives, usually cocci, gram-negatives, usually bacilli, but as you know, there's a handful of gram-positive rods, mycobacteria, not only the tubercle bacillus or acid-fast bacillus, which causes TB, but a few other bacteria like the atypical mycobacteria and leprosy, spirochetes, anaerobic bacteria, and obligate intracellular bacteria. So these last four, generally, with the exception of the aerobic, don't have easily gram staining patterns. The mycobacteria are stained by the acid-fast stain. The spirochetes don't really take up any good stain, but they have a characteristic appearance. The anaerobes are usually gram-negative. They're usually bacilli, and the most common of which is a gram-positive bacilli in the Clostridium family. And of course, we have this group of what we call quotes bacteria, but they don't behave totally like bacteria in that they can't be grown easily outside the human body, so they have to be grown inside of cells. We're also going to get into the fungal diseases, both the yeast and the molds, as well as the common yeast candida and cryptococcal yeast infections, the most important of which is a meningitis. And then we'll be talking a little bit about the hyphal or the molds and saying a couple words about Aspergillus and mucormycosis, both of which are infinitely more common in immunosuppressed patients. We'll get back into parasites again a little bit, zero in on a couple of life cycles, go into the protozoans and a couple of the worms. Okay, as promised, we're going to talk about four categories of viral diseases. And we said the first one was the transient acute viral diseases, the one that occur acutely, not only pathologically producing acute patterns of inflammation, but clinically acute, appearing suddenly. And of course, the childhood viral diseases like measles, mumps, polio, most of which are gone by now, as well as some which aren't, like West Nile, are all viruses which appear suddenly, can disappear suddenly, have a certain good amount of immunity attached to them in the convalescent phase, but some of which can be very severe. So let's look at measles, although you may never hopefully see a measles case. Measles is an infection, as you know, in children of skin, but it can also involve lung, brain, other tissues. And from pathology point of view, besides having the classic spot appearance, often causes fusion of some of the epithelial cells, so they appear to be like giant cells. So they talk about a measles giant cell. And unlike the giant cells we see elsewhere, these are not histiocytes. These are not macrophages. These are actually partially fused epithelial cells. Another thing to remember in measles is that it is a respiratory infection. There's usually severe upper respiratory infection. And often, before the appearance of the skin lesions, you could see, perhaps besides a pharyngitis, little white, whitish patches called coplic spots, K-O-P-L-I-K spots, named after Dr. Coplic. Here's another disease I hope you never see: mumps, infectious keratitis, involving primarily the salivary gland, the parotid gland, and usually one side more than the other. Often a benign disease, but also can infect pancreas, testicles. And whereas you can see a nice little swelling of this young man's left parotid gland and this young lady's left parotid gland, it's usually not really symmetrical. It'll affect one side more than the others. This is an actual histologic view, not of a salivary gland, but of a seminiferous tubule, in which you see infiltrates of neutrophils in that tubule. Pancreas can also be involved. Lung can also be involved. Central nervous system can rarely be involved. Here's another disease I hope you never see. It's poliomyelitis, caused by the polio virus. Here is an anterior horn motor cell, and you can see that it is starting to have an infiltrate of inflammatory cells. Here's a much wider and a lower power view of the process, in which you see edema, demyelinization, more infiltrates of inflammatory cells. This is a classical appearance for polio. And whereas in some of the other acute viral infections we saw, there could be regeneration, once these anterior motor horn cells are destroyed, there's no regeneration. So polio infection can result in very severe lifelong crippling disease. Here is an acute type of viral encephalitis. This one is West Nile. And like most of the other viral encephalitis or encephalitides, the primary histologic pattern is a little cuffing of lymphocytes around blood vessels in the central nervous system, the so-called Virchow-Robin space. So technically, there's a theoretical space surrounding blood vessels, and in the early stages of a viral encephalitis, whether it's West Nile or another type, you can see the infiltrates of inflammatory cells going around those blood vessels. Let's talk about the chronic latent viral infections as the second category, of which the herpes family is the main classification. You have herpes simplex virus, CMV, also in the viral family. I think I'll make that little M red if I possibly can. And we have the varicella zoster virus, also in the herpes virus family, causing a chronic latent pattern of infection, which means clinically it may resolve, but it may come back and go away and come back and come back years later, come back when the immunity is down, come back when the patient is immunosuppressed. These are viruses that just don't really go away too easily, but they can relax and not do much acute tissue damage for long, long periods. Here is a vesicle of herpes simplex in the arm. Here it is genital, and it's basically the same virus. There's a lot of crossing over, although technically the oral herpes simplex is HSV-1 and the genital is classically HSV-2. Here is a histologic view of the nucleus of some of the squamous cells. They can have these bright inclusions. These are not virus particles themselves. There may be viruses in them, but the virus itself is generally much, much, much smaller. Here is a CMV, also in the herpes family. In this case, also like herpes, often in immunosuppressed people. In this case, it's in the lung. It could be in the skin. It could be in the kidneys. And the classical feature of CMV is that, like herpes, you get these intranuclear inclusions, and here's a really good example of one. And normally, you don't have to look too hard to find them. But once you do, if you see a real specific basophilic intranuclear inclusion in an area of inflammation, most likely that is CMV. Because as far as I know, if you do a good stain, CMV is the only viral disease I could think of offhand that causes very distinct basophilic intranuclear inclusions. Here's a third type of chronic viral disease by the VZ virus. It's called VZ because it causes both varicella as well as herpes zoster. So the same virus that causes chickenpox causes shingles. Here's a classical dermatome appearance in an adult. Here's an inflammatory reaction in the area. Here's an actual vesicle. So like some of the herpes simplex, it's basically a vesicular pattern of skin reaction in which there's a lot of secondary inflammation. And let's move into our third category of viral type infections, are the so-called chronic viral infections, of which hepatitis is the most common. Now, you know, I think we'll have to stop here for a minute and continue with this in the next group.